And I'm such a complainer, you know, because so many things in life bug you, you see. Like, for example, I have another thing I want to talk to you about. Recently, I played in Washington, D.C., and I had a commute between Washington, D.C. and New York, my home, because I had shows to do in both places. And I discovered a new thing. It's called the Eastern Airlines Shuttle. It's an economy airline flight. And all those of you who have risked your lives with Western Airlines can sympathize with me. You know, $13 to L.A. and Our Father, which art in heaven. You know, and I got out there one day at LaGuardia Airport, and I know it's gonna be an old plane. I know that. I always expect when I get to that plane, it should have four wings, like be a biplane. And our captain's name will be Rickenbacker. And he'll have a long, white, flowing scarf, right? I know it's an old plane. I can still see the Jap flags along the pilot's window. It's like very good over Kwajalein. And I get on board the plane, and let's face it, gang, I can no longer ride coach. It's not that it's not status, it's just that it don't fit in a coach seat no more. And I sit there on that seat, and the seat's breaking, it's going pop, bang, snap, crack. And the stewardess, she's afraid to say something to me, because she figures if I say something to him, he might cut me. You know, she's thinking in terms of the old image, you know. So she says something like, have a peppermint, you know, and I say, nitwit, that's how I got this way. So I end up trying to remove the seat divider, you know, like, and that won't come out. My wife's sitting across the aisle making like she ain't with me, you see. Big fat color fellow. I don't know who the hell he is. What are you looking over here for, idiot? And the seatbelt on me comes to about here, right? So she says, fasten your seatbelt, looks at me and says, well, brace yourself, baby, brace yourself. So finally we take off out of LaGuardia and we got about 1,000 feet up and the pilot clicks on the intercom and he says, ladies and gentlemen, please continue to observe the no smoking sign. Unfortunately, we have lost the use of our third power plant. I mean, don't be euphemistic, damn it. That's an engine. We may die. You know, and with my luck, we'll get some guy in the control tower who'll say, well, honey, once you get off the ground, you're on your own. I mean, glide to Newark, you silly savage. Unfortunately, I got a real liberal guy, you know, so he lets us back on the runway. And I feel very confident. Once I get on the runway, I feel like I got it locked up because I'm sitting right up there next to that forward escape window, you see? And I know that if anything goes wrong, I can always open up that window and leap out into a spinning propeller. And I know the backup plane's got to be either a Zeppelin or a Piper Cub, right? I could just see the two guys in the hangar blowing up the Zeppelin saying, come on, Ernie, they got to get to Washington, blow. So finally, I get on this other plane they got there. And I don't mind economy flights, but when I ask for a drink of water, don't tell me to swallow hard. When I get there on the plane, they got one John for 95 people. So I always end up standing in the aisle like this, you know, like, and she goes, I say, what's the matter? And I say, nothing's the matter, idiot. I come from a long line of colored whooping cranes. Never thought of a colored whooping crane, have you? And I notice every time I land in Washington on this flight, they're always saying something like, there will be a 6-minute delay, there will be a 9-minute delay before we can deplane you. And I always wondered why that was, and finally it dawned on me. That is caused by the fact that they didn't expect you. You know, a guy comes out of the hangar and looks up and says, where the hell did that come from? They made it again. Law of averages done busted up our crap game in the hangar. Well, go get the ladder, man. I don't know where the ladder is. So I hate airlines, basically. And now what they're trying to do is they're trying to show me movies, you see, to relax me, get rid of my tensions while I'm on the flights. And I see a lot of good movies now. Like, I particularly like the Doris Day films because I like suspense, you know. Will she or won't she at 47 is very important to me. I like puberty rights. Then in coming in from New York a couple of Sundays ago to open the show here, I saw a great film, truly an epic, a thing called Zulu. Damn, we lost again. I mean, like 4,000 of us got whipped by 300 guys. You know, and you begin to get little hints that we're gonna get the short end from the very beginning. because when a British soldier fires a bullet, it goes right through 13 Zulus. See, because Zulus are very stupid. They attack in a straight line. You know, you can always see them say, get in line, baby, save bullets. And when a Zulu throws a spear, he's supposed to be very good with it, but you know, it's going directly through the heart of another Zulu. The British go into a village, they burn the whole village down, kill everybody in it. That's called a victory. We beat up one British soldier, it's called a massacre. And then you ever notice that Zulus and American Indians never fight fear? They always attack from the rear with a dirk, you know, like, ah. And they're always killed by an irate British officer with a rolled up copy of the London Times, you know. Like, take that, you savage. And then there's that always that final definitive scene in which they make very clear that we're supposed to get the short end. Because what happens is, they always have all the troops. The British troops are always lined up, and the commandant always walks out and he says, first platoon report, any casualties? No, sir, no casualties. Second platoon report, any casualties? No, sir, no casualties. Third platoon report, any casualties? No, sir. Oh, terribly sorry, sir, yes. Our favorite scout, Omar Ben Ahmed, was killed. Now you know who that is every time, baby. And he always says something like, colored, wasn't he? Pity. They're all of the same gender. You know, like, for example, the Tarzan films have always amused me, because I always see Tarzan out there on that branch yelling something like, Aya! And we're all supposed to run for the hills.
Hell, I heard worse sounds than that in my old neighborhood on Saturday night.
I mean, I could just see if Tarzan came to my old neighborhood some Saturday night and stood out there and went, Aya!
A cat would look out the window and say, who the hell is that out there making all that noise?
Say, well, it's a white man in a loincloth. Say, well, is he wearing a hood?